Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Thank you for spending part of this beautiful Sunday here with me. As you can tell, it's going to be all me today. Sharing, the only thing we're not, we're not going to be able to have healing because I don't know if anybody in here, is anybody in here a healer that wants to heal? So I'll just do a healing meditation, or we do a self-healing during the meditation. And I'll know a little bit about that today. I'd like to get some daily. Have you lit the candles yet?
We'll do that.
Do you like to light the candles? Symbolize on unity of body, mind, and spirit. Please do me a favor and silence your cell phones during the service. Please stand for an invocation. Remain standing for the first one. Dear Father God, we give thanks for this moment in time. May we all feel the purpose of the gathering here, the spiritual purpose, as well as our purpose for being here. May we feel the truth in that. May we be moved by that. And may our souls be shifted. We give thanks. Amen.
Well,
Amen.
We got Rocco Spiritualism Church. Rocco Spiritualism Church. Rocco hands and feet. How about we do Linda Saint have some fun with it? Get number nine. There's big debate among musicians which started first, the rhythm or the tune.
Yes. Big debate.
We'll have some fun with both of them. That's hymn number nine when the saints go marching in.
Oh, let the saints go marching in. Oh, let the saints go marching in. Oh, let the saints go marching in. Oh, let the saints go marching in. Oh, let the saints go marching in. Oh, let the saints go marching in.
And you know we're a jazzy church because somebody was clapping off the back seat. Good, 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 good.
And the last portion is a thought for today from the pastor. And I guess my thought for today is, if you're seeing things around you that need doing, the best thing to do is just to get on and do them yourself sometimes. You know, anybody can sit around and pick out what needs to be done and direct other people to try to do it. But the simplest thing is to just get up, hook up, and get it done. My wife Peggy had a surgery procedure and she's got three horses. So I've been shoveling horse manure for the last 3 or 4 days. But she's really upset. She's trying to get out there and do them. And, you know, she's got stitches and she's not allowed to pick up stuff that's too heavy. And she's, so rather than, and I'm not a big fan of doing that. So I went ahead, I've been doing it for 3 days. And this morning, I had to get up real early to do it. I knew in here there was several complaints about the toilets in there, especially in the women's room. So rather, and I know that Manny here, his store was flooded. His grandson OD'd on drugs, and he's at a funeral today.
So rather
than, you know, ask him to come up here and do it, I brought the stuff in and I cleaned it myself. On top of it, you see, neither of my co-pastors show up today, and I'm lecturing today. So I get to do all of that, plus chair, plus do everything else. And it'd be easy to just say, oh, the hell with it. Just cancel the service today. I'm not doing any of that. But the resources are here. My attitude is here. And you are here.
Yes.
So that all makes it work. That all makes it just a moment of creation that needs to be. And on the way here, I had an opportunity to give a random act of kindness to some guy sitting in a wheelchair out here at the corner of International Speedway and US 1. And he's got a Vietnam War vet cap on. And he's probably one of the first ones over there, because that's my era. And he looks a lot older than I do. So he's probably the first wave that went over there. And he's just sitting there with a sign that says, need help. I stopped my car right in the road. People beeping their horns at me, seeing this guy with a sign there with a Vietnam vet head on. I walked over and gave him $20. I'd have given him $100 if I had it to give to him. But it's all these opportunities that you have through your life. You know, you could always sit there, like I said, complain about the things that you see, you know, be upset about the things that are going on. But your duty as a spiritual person and a physical being, a moral and ethical being, is to correct what you can correct in front of you at that moment. Even if it's just a little thing, it doesn't have to be a big thing, it doesn't have to be noticed. Just a little effort, a little help, a little kind word, a little this or that, is all that's expected of you as a spiritual being and a moral and ethical being. So I would just say to you, that when the days besiege you, or it looks like it's going to be that type of day the next day, just get up, step into it one event at a time, do what you're capable of doing, and step away from it when you're done doing it. Don't feel obligated to do that which drives you down. Do what you're capable of doing. Do what you're capable of doing with a good spirit, and move away from it. Don't be bound by it. And that's what I've learned in the last few days, is that's how I handle my busy days. One event at a time. There's an old Florida saying, when you're in your ass up to alligators, you take care of the one that's in your face first, that's going to hurt you the most, and that's all you worry about, the one that's right in front of you at that moment. So just think about these things. Like I said, you can find yourself besieged by multiple tasks. They rarely have to all be done at exactly the same time. Do one at a time. Do what you feel comfortable doing. And don't be guilty of doing that which you don't want to do. And step away from it with a good attitude. So I thank you for listening. Please stand for the next hymn.
Thank you.
The next portion will be a healing portion, and as I said, we can do a video guided meditation for self-healing. The key to the self-healing isn't remembering all the words that are said. It's remembering the feeling that you connect into during the meditation. It's like trying to find a radio station on the radio. Once you find it, you know where it's at. And it's the same way with this. Once you connect to self-healing, you don't need to remember all the words that got you there, just the feeling. Just mind yourself back into that feeling, and it's there for you every time. And we'll start this by saying a prayer for spiritual healing and back to healing. I ask the great unseen healing force to remove all obstructions from my mind and body, and to restore me to perfect health. I ask this in all sincerity and honesty, and I will do my part. I ask this great unseen healing force to help all present and absent ones who are in need of help, and to restore them to perfect health. I put my trust in the love and power of God.
Flowing of blood and healing nutrients to that part of the body.
and more intensity and warmth. You begin to feel the breath focusing more to that area of your body. As you feel this healing taking place, you give thanks to that part of your mind for sending this. As you feel that healing and renewal occurring, you begin to pay attention to the entire bodily system. You begin to see your whole body as if a being of light. All points of light, every cell has this point of light to it. Every point of your DNA has this light to it. And you see these millions of points of light in the shape of your body responding to this attention that you're sending to it. You begin to ask the intelligence of the body, the cells, and the DNA for the spiritual intelligence to balance itself. And as you see this light from the body beginning to meld with the light from the spirit, you feel that wave of intelligence wash over you, the higher mindedness of the spirit side connecting to you in these points of light, causing the body to begin to balance itself as it was at creation, beginning to bring into balance all areas of discord, mentally and physically. You see your mind filled with this light as well. And as you feel this wonderful shower of light, you begin to feel the totality of all the spirit around you. And as you feel your body vibrating at the spiritual rate, no disharmony can exist at this level. Breathing rhythmically, balancing the energy as it flows into your physical body. Breathing and balancing as the spiritual intelligence flows through your body. Asking that your mind, body, and spirit become balanced as one. All expressions having their priority. All expressions being within their own realm. Feeling the totality of this. Breathing and balancing your spirit, mind, and body. Into this light and this balance and harmony, you now feel the awareness of another around you in spirit. As you feel the nearness of this one in spirit, the first thing you're impressed with is the undying love that this spirit has for you. The unending faith that this spirit has in you. And you begin to allow that presence to flow into your awareness. Greeting this presence. Greeting this spiritual being. Acknowledging its presence and its existence. Asking what it would like to have of you at this moment. What is it suggesting to you at this moment to make your life better and brighter, so that in turn you could share that brightness with others? First, you must have it yourself. Into this union of spirit mind and your mind, you are moved, whether consciously or subconsciously, by this moment of contact. You will be changed from this moment forward, and you'll have an intuitive knowing of what to do with your life. And as you make this contact and connection, you thank the Almighty Creator for this special messenger that has been sent to you. As you feel this completely snap. You begin to slowly begin to feel your breathing again. As you begin to breathe and feel this totality, you gently begin to come back to the here and now, but not severing this higher mindedness, holding on to this higher vision of you and your life and the world around you. There's no need to sever this calmness and harmony as you re-engage your senses, as you become aware of the world around you, doing it a little at a time, allowing both to co-create and coexist in the same moment. The spirit and the mind, the spirit and the senses, all willingly, cooperatively working in the same time, same place, same moment. Each having its own place and its own purpose in every moment that you encounter. Gently breathing, gently taking your time, reintegrating back to the here and now, holding on to the higher mindedness. Just gently taking your time, no rush, breathing rhythmically, balancing this energy, balancing this consciousness, balancing the presence of the spirit of love and hope that has come to you. Taking your time, gently beginning to feel the chair underneath of you, feeling the breath within your body again as your breath, feeling the hands in your lap. You begin to come aware, just gently begin to slowly open and close your eyes. Don't open them all at once. Just slowly open and close them, assimilating the spirit vision with the conscious vision, assimilating the spirit senses with your senses, being more than the sum total of what you were when you started.
See?
please be seated. Next portion is an inspirational lecture, and sometimes we may get weird from the clergy, we're going to have your name for that. I guess my walk with spiritualism began in about 1985, when I walked out into the Casanega Spiritualist Camp and went to their church in about mid-1985. And it sounded to me like I was in a meeting to try and stay sober. And I found out later on why. It's because Arthur Ford, one of the most recorded mediums of modern times, states in his book that he worked with a group to establish a step called a fearless and searching moral inventory of yourself daily, which is the fourth step of a group that calls me trying to stay sober. I did manage to stay sober. So that was the latest stage of my walk. My walk was one that was piecemeal over the years, because when I was from about 16 to about 35, I guess I was a pure hedonist of hellraiser and didn't do anything but drink and fight and just work every day. And I enjoyed it. I don't make any apologies for what I did at that time. I don't have any regrets about it. I was into it, and I knew what I wanted, I knew what I liked, and I did what I liked. But through knowing myself, regardless if that's who I was, Spirit was allowed to work with me. And that's why one of the greatest things that I've heard is said is know yourself. It doesn't mean make excuses for yourself. It doesn't mean tell yourself what you should be. It says know yourself here and now as you are. And if you're honest with yourself and you can state what you believe and what you feel and what you think, regardless of what it is, regardless of how big it is or how spiritual it is, God will work with you in your life as long as you state what you believe. And I'm not encouraging anybody to be a bigot or prejudiced, but I was a pure hedonist, and I knew it, and I didn't make excuses for it, and God was able to work with me. And the way that happened was one person at a time, one event at a time coming into my life. And in the beginning, I didn't feel I was responsible for anything that was happening to me. I just felt that I was in this flow, like, kind of like when you're swimming. You don't blame the water for getting you wet when you're out swimming. And that's how I looked at life. I didn't blame life for being life as I was moving through it. But I didn't take responsibility either. And as the events began to unfold with me, each person that came into my life began to teach me a little more about being responsible for myself and being responsible for what I did with my life, not just aimlessly flowing through this sea of life. And I mean, people do it until they die sometimes, aimlessly flowing through life. And they seem to be quite happy with it. But my life began to change when I realized that there was another reality. And again, it was one person at a time. First, it was a Catholic priest that came into my life when I was incarcerated for about 5 years of my life. And I was waiting to go to the penitentiary. And this priest came in and spoke to me for about 6 months when I was waiting to be transferred. And he had an effect on me. And right after him came this guy from Yogi Bhajan, Kundalini Yoga. I started learning Kundalini Yoga right after that, waiting to be transferred and stuff. And he began to speak about Buddhism and the beliefs of it. And that shifted me a little bit more, but I didn't really, I practiced that for about 4 or 5 years, and it just seemed to be not involved enough. It was too laid back for me. And that's for me, that doesn't mean that it's not true. These beliefs aren't true. These beliefs are true, and they did have an effect on me. but they weren't what I was looking for. And as I began to move through sobriety, I shifted even more. And the whole focus of the group, and they don't like you to use their name, I'm sure most of us know who it says, but they asked them not to use their name publicly. Their whole focus is to have a spiritual awakening in order to stop drinking. Every step they put you through, all the principles, all of the philosophies, are towards you having a spiritual awakening. I had my spiritual awakening prior to going to meet it. I had my spiritual awakening in the detox center. I was in a detox center for 28 days. I got forcibly put into a locker at my mind. Everybody had a drop of blood in common with me one night. They were afraid I was on my way back to prison. I had a wife and two young children at the time. And they were sitting in my house at 2 in the morning one morning when I came home to get a shotgun to go back for round two of the bar. I'd been beat up and thrown out. I still got a scar from here to here because of that fight. I went back into the bar 3 times and made them beat my ass 3 times and throw me out 3 times. And I decided I was going back with a shotgun. And my family was there in my house at 2 in the morning. Everybody that had a drop of blood in common with me for 50 miles around was meeting with my wife at that time to figure out what to do about me. So you talk about spiritual intervention in your life. And I had a big old beard at the time, and you know, looked like a pretty good outlaw at the time. And my brother comes up to me as I'm walking out the hall with a shotgun opened up, loading it. And I noticed the light was on in the living room, and I walked up in the living room, there everybody is there. And here I am with a shotgun, the blood all down the front of me. And my brother walks up and puts his hand on the shotgun. He goes, "We've made a decision here tonight." And he kind of blows a shotgun down my hand and says, "You're going to a detox tonight. How you go is what your choice is." He says, "It looks like you've had a pretty rough night already." He says, "Sober and straight, you can take any one of us in this room. But you've already been softened up, you're drunk, and there's 5 of us. So you're not winning this." So I got marched like a military swan into the car, drove to a detox center that was a lockup one, marched up to the desk, and put into a detox center for 28 days. My spiritual awakening occurred one day in there. 6 days a week, you have to go to classes and this and that, and most of it's, you know, with people in the detox center. Now, this detox center was kind of a difficult detox center because it wasn't one of the higher-ended ones. It was all the... There were hookers from the Orange Blossom Trail, drug dealers, you know, Skid Row drunks. It was not the good crowd of alcoholics. These were tough as hell people. And that's what it took for me. That's what I needed. And they used to, once every 2 days, they'd have this talk and vote who was least likely to succeed and who was most likely to succeed out of the 20 or 30 people that were in the group. I got voted least likely to succeed the first 3 or 4 times. Now, like I said, in this detox center, this is where my spiritual awakening came from. Now, this is the attitude that I had then. I was fighting everybody. I was bound and determined that I wasn't changing for nobody or nothing. 6 days a week, you had to go to classes. Had to. They'd come and drag your ass in there with orderlies and stuff if you didn't show up. 7th day, Sunday, a guy from AA comes in there and runs a meeting for people that want to sit in a meeting and learn about AA. I'd go in there and start arguing with them. Just the 7th day where I didn't have to do anything, I'm going there and pick an argument with this guy. This guy's an ex-non-vet, used to be a forward guard with the Montagnards in Vietnam. The Montagnards were a band of natives that the Viet Cong were afraid of because they were so secretive and so lethal. And they were fighting with the Americans over there. And he was one of the forward scouts with them, the American advisors. That's how tough this guy was. And he finally looked at me one day and he said, "Steve, why don't you just get up out of that chair and make room for somebody that wants to be in here? Because you haven't had enough to drink. You need to go back out and drink more because you just haven't had enough yet. Get up and get out of this room." And I got up and went back and sat on my bunk, and I was so mad that I couldn't see straight. And for a split second, there was a moment of calm that came into my life. This was the spirit touch. And I heard this rhythm of an old gospel song that I used to know. And I didn't know what it was at the time. It ended up being Kumbaya mode when I finally figured out what it was. But I heard this for about 60 seconds, maybe 2 minutes. And such a calm came into my life at that time that I hadn't known since I was in my early teens. My early teens, I was an Eagle Scout. I loved life. I was out in nature and really enjoyed people. And in 2 years, it went downhill. So I re-felt this feeling again. And from that moment on, I began to seek that feeling again. Now, I didn't get it right away. It took 2 years before I had more of it than I didn't have. But once you feel that spiritual consciousness, you seek it. And it's not this blinding light that undoes everything the moment that it happens to you. It gives you a direction. It gives you a purpose to reach for. It gives you a reality that you haven't had before. And through all the muck and mire that I've created in my life, through all the difficulty I had created for the people in my life, I had to wade through that. But that was waiting for me. At the end of every day, I had a few moments of it. Then it began to be that I had it for days at a time. Then I began to have it for weeks at a time. But it took years. It was not an overnight thing. But that momentary experience, that spiritual awakening, is what happened to me prior to ever going to any AA meetings. As I moved into spiritualism, I had more explanations of it. It began to expand on that spiritual consciousness. And it began to tell me about being responsible for my actions. And AA was the same way. You're responsible for everything you say, everything you do, every time you do it, no matter why you do it. If somebody attacks you and you harm them or kill them in self-defense, rightly so, you have still harmed or killed another human being. And there's a certain level of humanity that you will deal with from doing that in your own self. It doesn't mean you shouldn't have done it. It doesn't mean that there was another way. It means that you will deal with a certain level of your own humanity to put that into perspective for having done it. So you are responsible for everything you do, every time you do it, no matter why you do it. And when you begin to believe that, you have created the freedom for your life to find solutions. You have created the path to awareness of solutions in your life because you've stopped putting roadblocks of excuses, stopped putting roadblocks of justification there. You have moved those out of the way and have opened up the highway to the greater awareness of the purpose of your life when you do that. And it doesn't matter if it's cutting somebody off in traffic or bigger things. The philosophy is the same. And that's why I've stuck with spiritualism all these years, is because of that cornerstone of personal responsibility that radiates throughout everything they say and everything they do. Now, their feet are made of clay. They're not perfect people by any means. But that's the other side of the coin. By realizing what I've just said about personal responsibility, you also realize that you're a human being. And you accept that part of your existence too. You don't have to become this utopian idea of a guru sitting on a mountain levitating in order to get through life. You can be who you are here and now and still be a spiritual person. You can have all the failings that you have now and still be a perfectly spiritual person. You have certain ingrained reactions within you by the biological flesh and body you have for millions of years of environment, millions of years of instincts, of memory, cellular memory, instinctual memory, that you will automatically react to situations in your life. It's just like a baby doe. When the shadow of an eagle flies across it, the doe will shiver. It doesn't know what an eagle is, but it has that knowing. And we are the same way. When we are we're shocked, when we're suddenly put upon by situations unforeseen, we have that instinctual reaction. And you should not put yourself down for having that, because there's no way you're going to get out. When you've got this flesh, you're going to have that type of reaction at some point. And it creates incorrect actions on your part sometimes, maybe inappropriate actions. But again, you come back to your spiritual self and you allow yourself the grace of having been human for a few moments. Don't be bound by it, but don't justify it. Yes, that's exactly what I was, and I will endeavor not to do that next time. Personal responsibility moves you by those moments. There's a little saying that I like to say in conclusion. There's a baby eagle. And he gets knocked out of his nest into the barnyard. And he starts walking around the barnyard. And this mother chicken sees him there and gets him into the flow with the other chicks. So he walks around, scratches, and acts like a chicken for quite a while. And one day, he sees these eagles flying over him. Sees this wondrous ant bird with these beautiful wings, and he looks up and he says, "My, wouldn't it be wonderful to be able to fly like that and be that free?" And one of the other baby chickens, his baby chicken looks at him and says, "You're just a chicken, man. Keep scratching. Don't look up like that." So the moral of the story is you can scratch with the chickens or fly with the eagle. It's your choice. Thank you for listening.